I would request Chairperson to kindly reduce the speaker.
So for our next talk, I would like to invite Dr. Mukesh Girdhar, who is a senior dermatologist and a coordinator of Max Super Special Hospital at Patparganj. He is a national vice president of Indian Association of Dermatology Venereal Disease, and he is the president of the Delhi State Chapter. And he has been awarded the Times Healthcare Award in the category of Legends in Dermatology, and he has been recipient of various prestigious awards like Professor Sardari Lal Award and Professor K.C. Kandhari Award. He is also a member of the Urticaria Guidelines Committee and one of the authors of the consensus statement on urticaria. Over to Dr. Mukesh Girdhar.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of EDPACON, especially Dr. Vijay Arora, for inviting me to deliver this talk here. I'm going to talk about the pruritus. I will have to go through some journal slides also, besides going to specifically to the systemic pruritus. I have no conflict of interest to declare here. So we keep on talking about itch and pruritus. Let's know what's itch and what is pruritus. Itch is something defined subjectively as a poorly localized, non-adapting, usually unpleasant sensation which elicits a desire to scratch. Whereas itch is generally a localized thing where there is an evident alteration in the surface of the skin, but it may not be locally produced also. It may be produced somewhere else, but may be manifesting in the skin. Sometimes it can be generalized also, but the sensation generally lasts for a few minutes to hours. Whereas pruritus is a generalized condition, generally idiopathic, which occurs in the absence of any primary skin disease. So it persists for long periods, sometimes years together. Often it is the primary manifestation of a hidden inner disease. And what is chronic pruritus? Chronic pruritus is a pruritus which is lasting for more than 6 weeks' time. So most of the patients of pruritus will be of chronic pruritus who come to us. So chronic pruritus is a symptom, it's not a disease, as per the definition of International Forum for the Study of Itch. And when we cannot find the cause of pruritus, we call it PUO, as you people call PUO as something different. Earlier we used to call it as pruritus of unknown in origin, but now the definition has changed. We call it a pruritus of undetermined origin, actually. So if you look at this data, then you will realize how common is pruritus, how much is the problem in the society, actually. About 60% of the elderly may have pruritus somewhere. 8 to 9% of the general population has pruritus. 12 months prevalence of pruritus, these are not Indian data, they are European data, because we don't have any such studies here. The 12 months prevalence of chronic pruritus is about 16%, and the lifetime prevalence is 22%. So that means one out of us five people is going to have pruritus in our life. We are able to know the cause of the pruritus, the patient comes to us, but in a lot of patients, like 8 to 15% of the patient, different studies, we have not been able to find the cause of pruritus. And this, I said, these are all European studies, so in our country, this number should be even higher than 15%. So itch scratch cycle. What is itch scratch cycle? We all know, I will not go into this. Pathophysiology of itch, the cells involved. I'm just mentioning these slides here because this will, consume time, precious time, when we should be discussing the management part more, actually. So this is the pathway for the itch from the skin to the brain. So one thing I want to mention, the important the fibers which are involved here are the unmyelinated C fibers, which are there in the skin, which are responsible for carrying the, itch sensation. A lot of us think that giving antihistamine will take care of the itching. In fact, in chronic pruritus, in quite a vast number of patients, histamine is not the mediator responsible for the pruritus. There are so many others. And it is so much important to understand all of them before you really embark upon your treatment. So this is one classification of itch. What kind of itch we can have. So one is the pruritoceptive. Pruritoceptive means there is a skin disease and we are able to diagnose that and treat that and the itch goes away. Then you have a neurogenic itch and a neuropathic itch. So neuropathic is where the pathology is the central nervous system, whereas neurogenic is where there is no pathology in the nervous system, but then the neural pathways are involved, some receptors are involved, some neuropeptides are involved. And then the last is the psychogenic. So after this, we had another classification by FC, and this was, you know, dermatological, systemic, neurological, somatoform, that is psychosomatic, then mixed origin, and then the variety that is others, where there may be some other reasons which we will be coming to. So this is a very easy classification to understand, and these are the systemic causes of pruritus. So our topic today is systemic pruritus. So these are the systemic causes of pruritus, a whole list of systemic causes. So it becomes so much important to understand what the cause is. Now, between you and me, there will be a difference. As a dermatologist, I will be seeing a patient of pruritus and maybe investigating and diagnosing the cause of pruritus. But with you people, you would most likely have a cause beforehand. And you know the cause and accordingly you have to treat the patient. But sometimes a patient of pruritus may present to the physicians directly, to physicians only, will not come to us. And then it becomes handy for you to understand the various causes of pruritus. And the common causes of the pruritus in our setting are the renal, the most common are the hepatic, renal. Many of us don't realize that the cause of pruritus can be a plain simple iron deficiency anemia, which is quite common in our country. So plain simple iron deficiency anemia can be a solitary cause of generalized pruritus. So we must look at these small reasons also. And allergies we all the time try to diagnose. Most of the times we are over investigating our patients trying to diagnose allergies. Generally speaking, we don't do any allergy test, any specific allergy test in any of our patients with pruritus. Drugs is perhaps the most important group of causes which when we look at the pruritus in our patients, especially in the elderly when the patient is on polypharmacy. Many a times when we, you can't stop all the drugs, just like we say in dermatology, when you have a drug reaction, stop all drugs and see. It is not possible. Patient is having a cardiac problem, hypertension, diabetes, all these things need to be managed all the time. So then you have to understand what is the mechanism of a particular itch, what is the manifestation of a particular itch, and accordingly we proceed. Now, these are the long list of drugs. In fact, practically every drug can cause, but NSAIDs, antibiotics, antihypertensives are common, statins are common, antidiabetics, in this list, there is no mention of gliptins. Gliptins have come a long way, as a cause of dermatological problems, including pruritus in our patients. Now, this is the table which shows even the mechanism of, the pruritus because of a particular drug. Like, for example, the calcium channel blockers will cause the xerosis of the skin and leading to the skin inflammation and itching. Angiotensin receptor blocker, the ARBs, are going to cause cholestasis. And ACE inhibitors are going to increase the bradykinin and sometimes even cause angioedema. Here I want to make something very clear, because sometimes what happens, we suspect that ACE inhibitor is responsible for the pruritus, and the physicians, they comply with our advice, they discontinue ACE inhibitor, and after 3 weeks when the itching is not reduced, they start it again. In fact, the itching may take many months to go away when the reason is bradykinin. So if we stop AC inhibitor, we must see minimum for 6 months time before we can be sure that it is not ACB inhibitor which is causing the pruritus. Beta blockers also cause skin inflammation. Statins cause xerosis and they directly also cause eczematous eruptions. Amongst the antibiotics, we know antibiotics cause allergic reactions as well as non-allergic pruritus. They cause pruritus by different mechanisms. Amongst the hormonal preparations, OCPs are known to cause pruritus. So a lot of our patients, the lady patients, are on OCPs. So we must take that history also if their itching is associated with OCP. Sometimes these people have aggravation of their itching just before their periods. Similarly, the other drugs like tricyclic antidepressants can also cause cholestasis. So these are the common drugs, and NSAIDs in the end are a very common cause of pruritus, but generally they are associated with rash. Now let us see how to, you know, manage, how to look at the patient with pruritus. The patient comes to us with complaining of pruritus in a localized area. There is no rash, only excoriation marks may be there, but there is no lesion, no primary lesion. So the patient may be having itching on the upper back, nowhere else on the body, severe itching, intractable itching, and not responding to antihistamine. You may be dealing with a case of notalgia paresthetica. There may be myralgia paresthetica on the outer side of the thighs. We all have seen those patients. Most of the times, these patients may have symptoms like burning. Sometimes they will have dysthesias. But sometimes the only symptom is pruritus. And if pruritus is associated with any of these other symptoms, then you can very easily suspect these diagnoses. Branchoradial pruritus occurring on the outer side of the arms is another common case of neurogenic pruritus. Then you can have post-stroke pruritus on one side of the body, then phantom itch, brain tumors can cause localized itch, and so on and so forth. And even diabetic neuropathy can also give rise to a localized pruritus only, not a generalized pruritus. Now, generalized itch without the rash. So what are the causes of generalized itch? First, the commonest is the xerosis, especially in the elderly. Thyroid disease. Now, thyroid disease I will discuss a little more in detail. Iron deficiency I mentioned. Renal failure, cholestasis will come to. Lymphomas, leukemias. The connective tissue disorders, especially dermatomyositis, very itchy. Then we can have pruritus associated with anorexia nervosa even. So these days we see, we just now had a psychiatry lecture. So many of our patients, they lose their appetite, and because of so many deficiencies, including iron deficiency, they end up with itching. So in elderly, I have made this slide specifically for the elderly because it's a very unique set of situation where you have multiple things going on and then you have to pull out your diagnosis out of that. So the elderly may be having a renal problem, may be having a hepatic problem. Hypothyroid is a common problem. Sometimes hyperthyroid is responsible for itching. So these are the various, I will suggest that people can take the picture of this particular slide because this gives you idea as to what can be the particular manifestations of a particular itch. So this is the algorithm as to how we proceed with the chronic pruritus. If there are lesions, if there are no lesions, if there are no lesions, then there is a systemic cause, there is a neuropathic cause, there is a psychogenic cause, and to help us, we have all the list of investigations below. They are the baseline, first line investigations in pruritus. Now, how to manage? So, to diagnose different causes of pruritus, we have to take a good history, the onset of it, association with any drugs or any other setting, any other disease process, the severity of quality of itch, timing of the itch, the areas of the itch, exacerbating factors, relieving factors, and so on and so forth. So all these histories have to be extracted, and then we have to go for the investigations. The first table is the baseline investigations, and serum iron ferritin is very much there in the first line, and in the second line we have the electrophoresis, suspecting some malignancies also. Hepatitis specifically hepatitis C It is hepatitis C which causes itching, not hepatitis B. That would be very uncommon. So then EPP, that is the erythropoietic protoporphyria, that would be very rare. I don't think many of you would be looking at that. We take biopsies. We take biopsies in many of the patients who don't have specific lesions also, especially in elderly. If a patient's itch is getting relieved by anti-inflammatory agents topically applied, so obviously there is some inflammation involved, so we may have to take a biopsy. And so many patients with pemphigoid have been picked on biopsies only, clinically not having any lesion. And I will again re-emphasize, when we are talking of DIF and biopsy, a lot of patients with on gliptins, especially sitagliptin, have a lot of problem of pruritus and even bullous pemphigoid also developing. Simple candida anywhere on the body is good enough to cause pruritus. So look for those sites, ask for those sites. Now, what is the stepwise management? I thought my time was 20 minutes for this talk, not 15 minutes. Sorry. We go for the stepwise approach, the general measures. We have to manage the dry skin. We have to give the antihistamines, sometimes topical corticosteroid. In the step two, we have the causative adaptive therapy. We look at the cause and then accordingly we manage. I will go a little faster now because there are many slides remaining. So going to the causative therapy, if we have a known allergen, we avoid it. If we have implicated drug, we avoid it. And it may go on right up to the transplantations also, but this is the second line therapy we are talking of. And when we are deciding on the therapy, we must know what is the level of evidence of a particular therapy. Coming to uremic pruritus, in the uremic pruritus, in 1970s, there was a study where they reported it in 85% of patients. And now it has come down to less than 25%. And that is because of our better dialysis facilities. That will come in the next slides. The pathophysiology, there is a hyperparathyroidism. So that theory was there. Patients treated for hyperparathyroidism, they responded, but then again there were patients who were treated and they did not respond. So nothing is foolproof when it comes to uremic pruritus. So raised calcium and phosphate levels were suspected, histamine, mast cells, tryptase, xerosis. There are a lot of patients whom you treat xerosis very well, the pruritus goes on. So it's a multifactorial thing. And there is a very important immune hypothesis for the pruritus. There was a study in 1978 published where the narrowband ultraviolet B light therapy, which we routinely use for vitiligo and psoriasis, was used to treat these patients, and they responded. Their pruritus went away. And narrowband UVB works through only immune mechanism. And they went on to doing the narrowband UVB only on one side of the body, and still the pruritus disappeared on the entire body. So that means narrowband UVB was not directly acting on the skin, it was working through the neurological pathways only. So there are other so many theories which have been given for the the immunogenic basis for the renal pruritus. One of the simple proofs is you apply topical steroid, the itching goes away. So topical steroid will work as a immunomodulatory agent only. Thalidomide works very well. Not many people will know that thalidomide is a very, very useful drug in the uremic pruritus. But then we have to be sure that we are not dealing with a lady, with a child, in a childbearing age group that when we are deciding on thalidomide.
Sir, can we wrap it up now, please?
Yeah, sure. So, uremic pruritus, then we have the opioid hypothesis. In the opioid receptors, we have mu receptors, which induce itch. We have the kappa receptors, which suppress itch. And both agents have been used to treat the uremic pruritus. The mu receptor antagonist, naltrexone, has been used. It was successful in a lot of patients. It fails in a lot of patients. So kappa receptor antagonists like nalfurafine has also been used, and in a meta-analysis it was found to be very useful. Butorphanone, which works on both the pathways, have also been found to be very useful. GABAergics have been very useful, especially pregabalin works better. Pentoxifilin has a lot of side effects, not used. Thalidomide I mentioned, narrowband UVB I mentioned. So this is the general management of uremic pruritus. And this is the final algorithm, final treatment table for the uremic pruritus. We can try activated charcoal, we can give narrowband UVB if available, we can give gabapentine or pregabalin, we can give gabalinolenic acid, capsaicin hardly works, thalidomide is good, nalfurafine is good. Cholestatic, earlier it was thought that the bile salts were responsible, there were theories, but then it was seen that even the bile salts went down and the pruritus continued. So then cholestatic pruritus, and there was a theory that even progesterone may be working because a lot of ladies having intrahepatic cholestasis of pregnancy. So, but that did not, that theory also did not work. Histamine, serotonin have some role, and increased autotaxin hypothesis is there. So I'll come to the treatment straight away. So these are the treatment on cholestatic pruritus: naltrexone, naloxone, nalmefin, and we all know rhodeoxycholic acid. It works in a lot of patients. Rifampicin works very well. Cholestyramine, sertraline, and thalidomide. So the pruritus can be so severe that sometimes it can, you know, invite surgical procedures, including the liver transplant. So diabetes, localized, generalized, neuropathy based, or because of immune defense defects. Then thyroid disorder, hyperthyroid can cause itching, hypothyroid can cause itching, and the treatment of these diseases will alleviate itching.
Sir, I'm really sorry, but we really need to stop because the next people are actually waiting in the line.
Anyway, so I'm through 20 minutes also. So that's it. So thank you so much. This is the last slide which shows how to manage the impossible itch.
Thank you, sir. And I would like to invite Dr. Sood, sir, Dr. V.R. Sood, sir, to kindly honor our speaker and chairpersons. Next session is the much awaited session, the CPC, Clinical Pathology Correlation. And to moderate the session, we have teacher of teachers, our professor, Dr. N.P. Singh. He is having more than 35 years of clinical experience in medicine and nephrology. And the discussant is another academician, Dr. Rajat Jham. He is professor in medicine at GDB Hospital and UCMS. I would request both the academicians to kindly take over.